We are the the returning light of God Almighty. Amen?
Amen.
That's why he called us, so that we could be light carriers, but be his light. We are carrying his light. I want to share again vital, important information that we have entered a season of penetration. The body of Christ, God, I truly believe, is invading, penetrating, and pressing into darkness. I kept seeing like an arrow that's going into darkness. And it's important that we are careful so that not only that we don't touch the darkness, but we don't participate with the darkness. We are to expose the darkness. And if light is penetrating into darkness, that means more darkness is going to be exposed. In fact, see, light is beginning to eat up darkness. That's why you're going to see more and more stuff happen. You're going to see more and more people fall, and you're going to see more and more things get exposed, but you're going to see a harvest also. But that's up to the individual, what part they want to participate with. In John chapter 10 and verse 1, most assuredly I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs up some other way, the same as a thief and a robber. But he who enters in by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the doorkeeper opens, and the sheep hear his voice. And he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. And when he brings out his own sheep, he goes before them. He goes before them, amen. Not behind them, right?
Amen.
In other words, we don't lead the Lord. He leads us if we're really his sheep. And the sheep do what? Follow him. For they know his voice. This is vital. This is vital. Yet they will by no means follow a stranger, but will flee from him, for they do not know the voice of strangers. Jesus used this illustration, but they did not understand the things which he spoke to them. Then Jesus said to them again, most assuredly I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All whoever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved. And he will go in and out and find pasture. The thief does not come except to what? Steal and to kill and to destroy. I have come that they may have life and that they may have it what? Abundantly. Everyone say abundantly.
Abundantly.
So we know who's the thief. Satan and his kingdom. Demons, devils, whatever you want to call them. We're to hear his voice. He calls us by name. He goes before us so that we can follow. The only way that you're able to reject the voice of the stranger is if you're following the voice of the Lord. In other words, you won't reject it. The voice of the stranger is called the voice of death. It's called the what? Voice of death. Jesus said, I've come to give you life abundantly, but the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy. What he's trying to do is influence me and you to touch something. Anything that the enemy has, he wants us to touch. He knows that if we touch it, we're touching, it's the touch of death. Has everybody got it? It's the touch of what?
Death.
And 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Second Corinthians 10. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Verse 3. For though we walk in the flesh, in other words, we walk not in the, I don't want to say the flesh of the sin, that arena. What this translation is talking about, even though we walk in the physical realm. Amen. We do not war according to the physical realm. For the weapons of our warfare are what? Not carnal, they're not physical, but they are mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, which is a what? A memory lie. Amen. Casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ, and being ready to punish all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. So our weapons are not physical, but they are spiritual, against the attacks of the voices that influence thoughts, causing a spiritual touch, or what we call agreement. And that agreement is the touch of death. Remember, the wages of sin is what? Death. In Genesis 3. Touch of death, the touch of death. Genesis 3 and verse 1. Now the serpent. Well, let me share with you, the serpent does not represent life. In case you don't know it. It represents death. Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, as God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden. And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, the one that the serpent represents, God has said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you what? Touch it, lest you what? It was called the touch of death. She even knew it. If I touch and agree, in other words, again, it's not only the thoughts of it, but it always starts with a voice, a thought. Every thought has a voice, every voice has a presence. When the Lord began to give this to me, what he was expressing to me is, my people don't take this serious enough. They think they can just touch it and walk away and everything's okay. No, it's not. You just touch death. And once you've touched death, it begins to overtake you. And you don't even know it until it's overtaking you, unless you repent and turn from it and don't touch it again. Has everybody got it? Of course, then the serpent said to the woman, you shall not surely die. Hello. Why? He convinced her to what? Touch death. The serpent is unclean. When we eat, in other words, what you speak is what you what? Eat. So what the serpent's trying to do is get you to speak his words, so you eat his words. So you're actually eating death. And what we touch, so the serpent has knowledge, doesn't he? In fact, that tree is called the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. That tree produces death. Amen? So the knowledge of the serpent produces death. Has everybody got it? Amen. Good. 1 Timothy 4. 1 Timothy chapter 4. In verse 1, 1 Timothy 4, verse 1. Let's speak it. Now the serpent expressly says, expressly. In other words, is he trying to get your attention? Amen. He's like going, hey, slapping you in the head. Yo, listen up. Now the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, expressly says that in the latter times, are we in the latter times? Some will depart from the faith. Why? It says, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons, because they are touching knowledge that's producing death. It's called the touch of death. They're agreeing with it. Speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth. These are doctrines of demons. This is the knowledge of the serpent. It brings deception. I'm going to say again, it brings deception that it influences agreement or the touch of death. He also produces false wisdom. It's called demonic wisdom, which produces death. Everything that the serpent is associated with, the end result is death. Hebrews 2. We talked about all these professors and think tank people and whatever, and think that they're so smart, they're stupid. Amen. Compared to the things of God. Amen? Amen? You got these New Agers and all of this other stuff. Tree huggers. Oh, we need to save the planet. Forget the humans. They're more interested in saving animals than mankind. People will die to save an animal. But don't let a person sit there and croak to death. That's because of doctrines of demon and deceiving spirits. Amen. This is influence. Hallelujah. Hebrews 2:14. Hebrews 2:14. Is that what I said? Thank you. Inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had power of death. That is the what? Hello? He's got power of death. Has everybody got it? So anything that you touch, according to the devil's doctrines or influence, it's a touch of death towards me or you. And released those who through fear of death were for all their lifetime subject to bondage. For indeed, God does not give aid to angels, but he does give aid to the seed of Abraham. Whoa. Therefore, in all things he had to become like his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make propitiation for the sins of people. For in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to aid those who are what? Tempted. If they're what? Hearing. That's why the word always says, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says. Why? Because God is always trying to make of it a way of escape. He knows that if you've touched something, if you've touched death, he's trying to get to you as quick as possible to say, repent. Why? Because then the blood of Jesus cleanses you so that you can turn away from it. But he says, don't go back and touch that again. See, he calls, look at, when you and I get freed from something, you go back and touch that, he calls that an abomination. Because he says, now you're trying to build on things I just freed you from. That is one of the worst things that you and I can do. It's called an abomination. Why? Because it's an instant touch of death. Ephesians 4. See, now people think, well, I'm not dying, but you are and don't know it. In other words, life has ceased now. Does everybody get it? When you touch death, life stops. Now death begins to take over until you turn from it and repent and get washed. Well, nothing's happened yet. Oh, it will. It will. Ask those people that died. You can't. But you'll know them by the fruit, right? Hallelujah. Ephesians 4:26. Please don't go seeking the dead and ask him why. You'll be opening yourself up to more death. It's called necromancing. You touch death again. 26, be angry and don't sin. That's called righteous anger. That's where you're to hate evil. Be angry and don't sin and don't let the sun go down on your wrath, nor give place to the devil. Why? If you give place to the devil, are you touching death? Yes. Let him who stole steal no longer, but rather let him labor working with his hands what is good, that he may have something to give to him who is in need. And let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth. Why? Is that life or death?
Death.
But what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers? And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. Be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you. Why? Because everything that's anything that's not God is death. Don't give place to the touch of the devil. Why? Because it's death. 2 Corinthians 6. Hallelujah. Verse 17. 2 Corinthians 6, 17. It says, therefore, that means if you will do this, if you will what? Come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord, and do not touch what is what? Unclean. Is it, if it's unclean, is it the touch of death?
Yes.
And I will receive you, and I'll be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. Don't give place to the touch of the devil, and don't touch what is unclean. Look at anything that's unclean is associated with death. Anything that's unclean according to God is death. Does everybody get it? It's death to me and you, isn't it? Proverbs 23. Again, I want to repeat, because we are in a season of penetrating darkness, it doesn't mean that we are to approve or partake or touch darkness, because that's death. So I want to grab hold of this. So life, the light, life is invading death. And those who are bound by death, God is pulling out. So light is beginning to eat up darkness, because life is beginning to eat up death. That's why we're in this season right now of penetration. That's why it's vitally important for me and you to be prepared and ready, armed up, filled up, empowered up, and having discernment so we don't touch anything. Don't agree with people that are speaking death or promoting death. Proverbs 23 and 31. Oh, hallelujah. Let's start at 29. Who has woe? Who has sorrow? Who has contentions? Who has complaints? Who has wounds without cause? Who has redness of eyes? Those who linger long at the wine. Those who go in search of mixed wine. Do not look on the wine when it is red, when it sparkles in the cup, when it swirls around smoothly. At the last, it bites like a what? Serpent, and stings like a viper. Your eyes will see strange things. Your heart will utter perverse things. Whoa. Yes, you'll be like one who lies down in the midst of the sea, or like one who lies on the top of a mast, saying, they have struck me, but I was not hurt. They have beaten me, but I did not feel it. When shall I awake that I may seek another drink? So understand that, you know, so many people don't realize that alcohol, doesn't matter what it is, it's just nothing but liquid dope. It's death. I've never seen an alcoholic, hello, or people drink. In fact, booze is the worst thing that you can intake. It's lasting effect. It's like jet fuel. Unfortunately, you don't move like a jet fuel, but you'd be dying like jet fuel. So you have to be careful of these things. Look, there's many people that approve of drinking. You and I can't. You and I can't touch it. You and I can't touch cigarettes. You and I can't touch these things. Why? Because it is a touch of death for you and I. Why? Because did God deliver you from it? Well, then it's an abomination if you go back to it. Anything that you've been delivered to, if you go back to it, it's an abomination. That means you've touched death. And death is now beginning to, again, when you touch death, life stops. And death begins to take over until you turn from it. Amen? In Matthew 12. Verse 43. Let's speak it. When an unclean spirit goes out of a man, hello, that's called a spirit of death also, isn't it? He goes through dry places seeking rest and finds none. Then he says, I will return to my house from which I came. And when he comes, he finds it empty, swept, and put in order. Then he goes and he takes with him seven other spirits more wicked than himself. In other words, that can influence more. And they enter and dwell in that in there. How did they enter? Agreement. That's all it took was a voice of agreement. And the last state of that man is worse than the first, so that it shall be with this wicked generation. Wow. Unclean spirits promote death. Only those that do the will of God obey the word of God. And what does that do? It keeps them from touching death. So when you are obeying the word of God, you're putting it to practice, what's it doing? It's telling you, it's reminding you, the Holy Spirit is using the word to bring to remembrance, don't touch that. Don't agree with that. Don't say that. Okay, you blew it. Repent and turn away. Run! Depart quickly. Get out of there. 1 John chapter 2. In verse 15. Hallelujah. Do not love the world or the things in the world. Why? Because who's the ruler of this world? Satan. Is he promoting, is he the spirit of death or the spirit of life? Death. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the what? Lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. It is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away, and the lust of it, but he who does the will of God abides forever. So we see here that lust and pride is touching death. The word says, pride goes before a fall. And we know that pride protects self, doesn't it? So lust of the eye, lust of the flesh, and the pride of life is the touch of death. And because of those things, you're not doing the will of God. A person that's full of pride or lust of the eye, lust of the flesh, is not doing the will of God. It is death. In Joshua chapter 7. Joshua chapter 7. So do we want to be able to discern things so that we don't touch death? Think about this. This is powerful. Judas, when Jesus was Judas Iscariot, right? When Judas decided to betray Jesus, first of all, it started because it says that the devil had influenced him and already had been taking part of him already. So when they left the Last Supper, Judas went and betrayed Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. And so when Jesus was in the garden and they were praying, they were gathering together, Judas came with the soldiers. And he walked up to Jesus and he kissed him Actually, they kissed one another. But he kissed him. And what that was the kiss of betrayal. Jesus kissed him with the kiss of death. Does everybody understand that? Why? He called him friend. He did not call him brother or servant. He called him what? Friend. Does everybody get it? He called him what? Friend. See, in reality, when Judas was kissing Jesus in the kiss of betrayal, he was actually, because what you sow is what you reap, he was actually being kissed back, a kiss of death. But it was a righteous kiss, wasn't it? It was different. And Judas ended up what? Hanging himself. He was so tormented because of the demons. In Joshua chapter 7, in verse 10, so the Lord said to Joshua, get up. Why do you lie thus on your face? Israel has sinned, and they have also transgressed my covenant, which I commanded them, for they have even taken some of the accursed things and have both stolen and deceived, and they have also put it among their own stuff. Therefore, the children of Israel could not stand before their enemies, but turned their backs before their enemies because they have become doomed to destruction. Why? Because they had taken accursed items. Neither will I be with you anymore unless you destroy the accursed items from among you. Does everybody see that? So having accursed items, is that a touch of death? Yes. My goodness. It's amazing how many people wear skulls on their... They promote skulls and crossbones. I walk up to many people. I'm at Christian events and they got skulls and crossbones. I go on to bike motorcycle events and these are Christian events. They got skulls and naked women and stuff on their motorcycles and I share with them. I thought you were a believer. I am. Well, do you promote life or death? I promote life. Then why are you wearing that and why is that on your bike? That is not promoting life. That is promoting death. And you're going to bring a curse on yourself for promoting it because you're approving of it. And you'll be judged the same way. Amen? Oh, hallelujah. So in these accursed items, you and I got to have discernment, don't we? So he said, get up and sanctify the people and say, sanctify yourselves for tomorrow because of thus says the Lord God of Israel. There is an accursed item, a cursed thing in your midst, O Israel. You cannot stand before your enemies until you take away the accursed thing from among you. It's amazing in how many people, how many believers, so-called believers, don't believe this. They don't believe it. Hallelujah. In Galatians chapter 5. Listen, God is raising up soldiers. This is a military operation where we must fulfill the mission. Time's running out. Galatians chapter 5. So don't buy frisbees and things like that that have skulls on them and crossbones and demonic dudes. You know what I'm saying? Galatians 5 and verse 16. Let's speak it together. I say then, walk in the Spirit and you shall not what? Fulfill the flesh. Fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish or that you will touch it. Touch death. But if you are led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident, which are. Now what he's actually telling me and you is if you do these things, you're touching death. Adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, which is also associated with drugs and alcohol, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, which I tell you beforehand, just as I also told you in time past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Why? You can't inherit the kingdom of God if you're touching death. First Corinthians 5. So works of the flesh is touching death. In verse 9. Is everybody okay? Amen. Are you getting this? We need to make this more of a reality so that when we see things going on, we're realizing, man, that person's touching death. Or, first of all, you better recognize whether you're touching death or not. In verse 9, let's speak it. He says, I wrote to you in my epistle not to keep company with sexual immoral people. Yet I certainly did not mean with the sexual immoral people of this world. Because he doesn't expect us, me and you, to keep company with the world. Or with covetous, or with extortioners, or idolaters, since then you would need to go out of the world. Need to go, yeah. But now I have written to you not to keep company with anyone named a what? Brother or a believer or a Christian who is sexually immoral or covetous or an idolater or a reviler or a drunkard or an extortioner, not even to eat with such a person. Why? Because then you're approving it. For what have I to do with judging those who are outside? Do you not judge those who are what? Inside. It's your responsibility to judge the inside. Amen? But those who are outside, God judges. Therefore, put away from yourselves the evil person. I think people have a hard time with that because they're too soulish. They're too emotionally involved. You can't make decisions by how you feel. You must make decisions by what God says, not what you feel. Amen? Oh, hallelujah. There are brothers and sisters in Christ that have touched death, and they are carriers of death, and what they want to do is actually influence you. And if you approve of them, you will be touching death. Next thing you know, you're going to start losing stuff. The devil's going to access you for stealing. He's going to come and steal, kill, and destroy the things that you're associated with. People's marriages fall apart because one is agreeing or approving. People's businesses begin to fade. People begin to lose things, get in debt, because they're agreeing or approving things of debt. First Corinthians, I think. Chapter 6, while we're here. It's the next chapter. In verse 8. No, you yourselves do wrong and do what? Is anybody there? 6:8. And cheat. Don't cheat. No, you yourselves do wrong and cheat, and you do these things that to your brethren. Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revelries, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. Why? Because they touch death. Has everybody got it? And he says, and such were some of me, and such were some of us, but you were washed. Because you repented and turned. And the blood washed you, didn't he? So now you're touching life. But you were sanctified, but you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus by the Spirit of our God. Now look at this. All things are lawful for me, but not all things are helpful. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of any. Wow. 2 Timothy chapter 2. Unrighteousness. 2 Timothy chapter 2. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We want the truth, right?
Amen.
2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 8. Let's speak it together, please. Remember that Jesus Christ, the seed of David, was raised from the dead according to my gospel, for which I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even to the point of chains, but the word of God is not chained. Therefore, I endure all things for the sake of the elect, that they also may obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. This is a faithful saying. If we died with him, we shall also live with him. If we endure, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he will deny us. So is denying him touching death?
Yes.
If we are faithful, if we are faithless, he remains faithful waiting for us to turn, and he cannot deny himself. Remind them of these things, charging them before the Lord not to strive about words to no profit, to the ruin of the hearers. Be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, and rightly dividing the word of truth. But shun profane and idle babblings, for they will increase to more what? Ungodliness. 2 Timothy chapter 3, while we're here. Oh, it's good to hear the pages turning on it. Tuesday night. In verse 1, 2 Timothy 3, verse 1, but know this, that in the last days perilous times will come. For men will be lovers of themselves. Are they touching death? Yes. Lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, which means control over the old man, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. They have a form of godliness, but denying its power. And from such people do what? Turn away. Why? Because they are carriers of death now. Amen? Because they've touched death, and you can't approve of those who are touching death. How about music? I'm telling you, music is the number one killer, besides pride. Well, listen, think about the music. Look at how technology has increased tremendously, the internet. You got pornography, you got all kinds of stuff. Music. People are addicted to music. In fact, sometimes people worship the music instead of the Lord. But man, I'll tell you, music, the kids today are listening to so much stuff. And you know what? It's pretty amazing because when somebody backslides and falls, you know what they start doing? They go right to back to worldly music, which feeds the addiction. You know what's feeding? Death. It's just feeding death. They start listening to the music. Listen, whatever is not of God is of who? The devil. And so if it's of the devil, is it promoting death? Yes. Yeah. So when you're in places where they're playing death music, it's trying to get you to touch, you shake the dust off and command those corruptible seeds to wither and die and get out of there. Music. Titus chapter 2. Verse 11. For the plan of God, which is called grace, that brings salvation has appeared to all men. So God is making a way, isn't he? Teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age. And it's called the age of grace, but in the present age of the world, it's an age of darkness. Looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed. That he might redeem us. I want you to know that might, that word might means that by your cooperation. That he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people, zealous for good works. Speak these things, exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no one despise you or deceive you in touching death. Remember, the plan of God is a plan that gives grace, is known as the plan of God to escape the deception of the devil and the wrath of God. Amen? In Revelation 21. You know, the word says that the wrath of God comes upon those who are disobedient. Revelation 21 and verse 6. We need to look at things more in the arena of life and death. Because see, when you don't look at things as life and death, then you're in a compromised state of being. And that's dangerous. 21, verse 6, is everybody there? And Jesus said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give of the fountain of the water of life freely to him who thirsts. So you got to be thirsty, don't you? If you're thirsty and hungry, are you hot? Yes, you're not lukewarm. He who overcomes shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. But the cowardly, unbelieving, abominable, murderers, sexual immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. Why? Because they touch death. Amen? They touch death. And I'm going to close at 1 Corinthians 15. If you didn't, you're going to get it. First Corinthians 15 and verse 50. Glory. Is everybody there? Let's speak it. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does corruption inherit corruption. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall it be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be what? Steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. The touch of death. It's kind of like the kiss of death, isn't it? The word says that the wicked one can't touch me and you when you are right with God because you're under protection. But he tries to sway you to touch death yourself. Amen? He might not be able to touch you, but once you touch it, once you touch them, once you touch darkness, once you touch death, then he has access to you to touch. Again, I want to share that once you've agreed and approved or touched death, life stops. Until you turn from it. Amen? Praise God. Remember, we are penetrating right now. The body of Christ is penetrating, infiltrating. We are in darkness. We're bringing the light into the darkness. Wherever you are, wherever you're going, do not deny Christ. Because he'll deny you. Amen? Father, we thank you for your word. We are honored and blessed. Pray, Father, that the seed of revelation and impartation will become a reality to each and every one of our hearers and watchers and those that are watching. I apply the blood of Jesus on the seed so it will be protected. And Lord, I'm asking it to be rooted into every single one. that will grow and bear fruit for your glory, and that you will remind them, bring quickening to each and every one of us by the Holy Spirit of the things of death and the things of life, so that we may be a life carrier to those who have been touching death, and that they may receive life in exchange for death. But if they're not willing, we commit them in your hands. In Jesus' name.